Hi, I'm Nicky Fox, and I'm the Director of the Heliophysics Division at NASA Headquarters. And today, I'm delighted to be able to tell you about some of the new things that are going on in the division. Well, before I do that, I wanted to take a moment just to tell you really what heliophysics is. Heliophysics is the study of our neighboring star, the Sun, and everything that the Sun influences. So the Sun's atmosphere continually streams away from the star. It moves away in a spiral pattern from the center of our solar system and reaches all the way out to the very edges. In fact, it kind of carves out a protective bubble for our solar system as we are orbiting around the Milky Way. And so this boundary is a very tenuous boundary, but it really keeps and protects us from the vagaries of interstellar space. And I'm going to be telling you about some spacecraft that have actually now left that protective bubble and are exploring areas where we've never been before. But why we really care about heliophysics is because the Sun really has an impact on us here at Earth. The Sun is a very dynamic star, and it can have many different types of eruptions that can cause particles and plasma to come rocketing away from the Sun at millions of miles an hour. And you see there are coronal mass ejection leaving, but also all those energetic particles that were also associated with that event, they stream down the magnetic field line and of course can impact our technology, causing really some quite bad effects. We also can have effects on our power grids, as well as our ability for our GPS spacecraft and radio propagation. So lots of things are really susceptible to the activity on the Sun. The way we do this is to put observatories, to put spacecraft in exactly the right location to form this wonderful system observatory. And here you can see a bevy of different spacecraft, some focusing on the Sun, others focusing on the area around our Earth, and others even further away, the voyagers that have actually left our heliosphere. And so we use all these data together kind of as one system. So it can really allow us to look at the Sun, take images of the Sun in all different kinds of wavelengths, and then sense the solar wind, sense that plasma as it moves away from the Sun, and then look at the impact that we see here at Earth, both in the magnetosphere and then down closer to the Earth in the ionosphere-thermosphere system. But I wanted to take a few moments to tell you about some of our new results. And so Parker Solar Probe launched in 2018, and has been doing great, great work. She's completed 6 flybys through the Sun's corona, going very close to the Sun on one side of her orbit, and then out around the orbit of Venus on the aphelion. On our very first orbit, we discovered these strange features in the solar wind. They're called switchbacks, or they're like little S-shaped curves. And if you think of taking a garden hose and twisting it, and then as it releases, it would kind of release energy. And so this is definitely a smoking gun for one of these mysteries that have just baffled scientists for decades and decades. Why is the corona 300 times hotter than the surface of the Sun? And why is this material energized so much that it moves away and streams away from the Sun and bathes all of the planets? Features like these switchbacks, these S shapes, and the relaxation are definitely candidates for the mystery of coronal heating. So Parker Solar Probe, really close to the Sun, Voyager all the way out, the furthest spacecraft from the Earth. They were originally launched in 1977, and they're in what we call an extended mission. So once they completed their initial mission, we discovered they'd done all of their sort of planetary flybys, and they were out in the very far reaches of our heliosphere. And so we've been able to use them to get really amazing interplanetary and now interstellar measurements. And it's really allowed us to expand the NASA's exploration of the solar system beyond the neighborhood of even the outer planets to the very outer limits of the Sun's sphere of influence, and then beyond, continuing our search for new phenomena and to really characterize the outer solar system environment. Earlier this year, Solar Orbiter joined us in the constellation. She is kind of the sister mission to Parker Solar Probe. Solar Orbiter has an in-situ set of instruments that are very complementary to Solar Probe, but also a complete suite of remote sensing instruments. And so as Solar Orbiter continues in her journey, she will actually lift out of the ecliptic plane and allow us for the first time to take images of the poles of our star. And you can see those first light images from Solar Orbiter there, just spectacular close-up images of our wonderful star. New to the fleet, we just selected this mission this year, is Sunrise. Sunrise is an array of 6 CubeSats, so very tiny spacecraft that will go into the solar wind, kind of separate, and then almost talk to one another and act as one very large radio telescope. So Sunrise will help us to study how the sun generates and releases giant space weather storms, these solar particle storms that can impact our technology. And really help us improve our understanding of how our solar system works. And it will, of course, help us protect our astronauts as they travel to the moon and Mars by better understanding the sun's radiation, but also how better protect our technology here at Earth. Another new mission that will be joining us soon is the IMAP mission. So IMAP, we actually just purchased a launch vehicle for IMAP. IMAP will now, we know, is going to launch on a Falcon 9 full thrust. And IMAP has got a kind of dual use. From its vantage point at L1, a million miles upstream of the Earth, IMAP is perfectly situated to observe particles that are accelerated by these transient events on the sun. And there are a broad array of competing theories for what causes these particles, what causes them to be accelerated and transported. And so IMAP will be able to test all of these different predictions and identify the right one. Also, IMAP is imaging the very outer boundary of our heliosphere. And so you can see a sort of ribbon feature there on the left-hand picture. And that is the IBEX ribbon. And it is a band of enhanced energy particles that are sort of superimposed on a very slowly varying background. And that actually encircles the whole celestial sphere. So the sun is in the very center there. And this big boundary is encircling the whole sphere. The ribbon is circular, and it actually it traces the region where the interstellar magnetic field is perpendicular to the radial direction from the sun. And then you can also see there another feature at higher energies. We have observed a belt of emissions that is much broader, and it's kind of offset from the ribbon. But we really don't know what is causing these two features, and IMAP will definitively determine the origin of the ribbon and its connection. GDC. Is a new mission, again, just in formulation, moving into phase A right now. It is the Geospace Dynamics Constellation. It'll be 6 small spacecraft orbiting in a constellation. And GDC really uses the upper atmosphere as a natural laboratory for understanding our home and also other worlds. It will allow us to do two-way views of magnetosphere-atmosphere coupling, and also to look at the universal physics of neutral gases and magnetized plasma and how they kind of interact with one another. The Earth's thermosphere is very similar to the Martian atmosphere, and so we can do some comparative planetology here, because what we learn about the Earth's thermosphere, we can apply to Mars. And then, of course, space weather. This is a region where terrestrial weather from below meets space weather from above. And there's a big sort of interaction between these two weather systems. And in that interaction, you can sometimes see bubbles, and that causes problems for cell phones, for GPS and other radio propagation. Also home to where the big currents form that have impacts on power grids. And then the last thing I'll just talk about is Hermes. Hermes is a small instrument suite that will fly on the first stage of the Lunar Gateway. And of course, one of the first things people want to know before they take a trip is what the weather is going to be like wherever they're headed. And so for our Artemis astronauts, they'll be traveling on missions to the moon. And so we'll be providing them kind of weather alerts, telling them what the radiation environment is like that they will be living and working in. And so we're excited also to have a European Space Agency contribution, URSA, that will fly with us and allow us to do fantastic work for our astronauts. And so I hope you've enjoyed hearing some of the highlights of what's going on in the Heliophysics Division today. And we look forward to sharing many more results with you as these new missions come to fruition.